The Lord be with you. Good morning, everyone. I am Pastor Miguel Arenas, and I welcome you to this holy place. We also welcome our brothers and sisters who are worshiping with us online. Today is a special day. Today is Christ the King, the last Sunday before we begin. Excellent. Before we begin Advent. It's amazing that we are almost there. We are almost there. So today we will have our last sermon of this extended 11-week sermon series about what it means to be United Methodist, and we call it Back to School. So today we will be speaking about worship, the importance of worship for us, and how valuable it is to worship. So let me ask you, are you ready to worship today? Wonderful. I love that energy. Let me try it again so you can give me that energy to me. Are you ready to worship?
Yes!
Fantastic. So the first task will be to stand up as you're able so we can participate all together in the call to worship.
We have come to worship the King of Kings and Lord of Lords.
We have come this day to worship Christ the King.
He is God who became man, love in the flesh.
He who healed sick and made blind to see.
He who taught us to love our neighbor and to help those in need.
He who loved us so much that he gave his life for our sins.
Rejoicing in the presence of the King of Kings, Jesus Christ. At his birth, the angels proclaimed his name to be Emmanuel, God with us. Today, in this place, in this time of worship, may we truly feel the power and presence of Jesus Christ as King of our lives.
May our hearts and spirits be challenged to proclaim with our lives, Christ is Lord.
Amen.
You may be seated.
Oh.
Let us now lift our joys and concerns. Alan Barb asks prayer for Karen, who is in the ICU. For Barb, who will have a hip replacement on Tuesday. For family traveling home. And they lift prayers for Sandy, who is sick. Kathy Hoover lifts up her nephew Dan, having back surgery tomorrow. Eric and Sharon lift up Don and Terry, traveling mercies on their return to California. Let us pray. Into your care, O Holy One, we entrust all for whom we pray, confident in your abundant and abiding mercy. May they sense your steadfast presence surrounding them and find peace in your care. This we pray in the name of Jesus Christ, our Savior. Amen.
Now is the time for the kids, so I invite all the children to come forward. Do we have anybody here? I think you are the only one, Brooklyn. Is that okay? Okay. Well, we appreciate that you are here with us this morning. How are you doing? How is Turkey? Good? Okay. Oh, there. Run. Good timing. It's so good to see you, girls. So my question to Brooklyn goes, how are you doing? You doing fine? Okay. Well, let me tell you something. Have you noticed that we use all the time this thing? Does anybody know what it is? Can you show yours? Look at them. All of them has one of these ones. Does anybody know what we use this little handbook? Yes?
To know what things are happening and what order.
Okay, to know what is happening where?
Here.
Oh, here! Yeah, what is happening here? And does anybody know how do we call this little thing? No? Let me ask some help. How do we call this thing?
Bulletin.
Yes, some people call it worship guide. Other ones call them worship bulletin. And does anybody know what do we have here in this? We have, as you said, instructions of what we're going to do, what we're going to sing, what we're going to pray. And you know, I have to tell you that these really help us to be guided in the worship service. Some people would say, we don't need a bulletin because we know what we are going to do, right? And sometimes people say, oh, I can even close my eyes and really know what is coming next. Well, let me tell you, some people, when I'm preaching, they also close their eyes. Yes. And you know what, Brooklyn? There was a time when Jesus was preaching to he was talking to his disciples, and suddenly people start complaining because Jesus' disciples didn't wash their hands before eating. And they didn't wash their hands. So Jesus said to them, why are you rebuking them? Why are you saying that? What is more important, to have a time together or to wash your hands? And Jesus, of course, was not saying that we don't need to wash your hands, because you know that germs are Jesus are everywhere. You know that? Yes. But what happened is that many times, we keep rituals and we keep things in our life that they don't benefit us because we do it mechanically, right? We do it mechanically without feeling it. And Jesus said the following, and I'm going to read it for you because I think this is very important. Jesus said, These people honor me with their lips, but their hearts are far from me. They worship me in vain. Their teachings are but rules taught by men. So what we have to learn from this? That when we come to worship, we don't do things mechanically. What we do is to express our own hearts and what we have for Jesus, to praise him with all our hearts, with all our energy, right? You don't pray God like this. I am so happy. I am so happy. Right? How do you express that you're happy? With a big smile, right? Can we sing that? I am so happy. I am so happy. So now, every time when you worship the Lord, do it with all your heart, with all your mind. And if you want to move, you can do it with all your body too. That's very important. Awesome, right? So let us bow our heads and pray. Dear Lord, you have to repeat. Dear Lord, help us to remember that we are in this place to worship you, and the true worship comes from the heart. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Okay, let's go and practice worship with all our heart. My brothers and sisters, I invite you to stand up as you're able. As I said, the peace of the Lord be with you. Please offer signs of peace to your brothers and sisters.
Psalms. Praise the Lord. Praise God in his sanctuary. Praise him in his mighty firmaments. Praise him for his mighty deeds. Praise him according to his surpassing greatness. Praise him with trumpet sound. Praise him with lute and harp. Praise him with tambourine and dance. Praise him with strings and pipe. Praise him with clanging cymbals. Praise him with loud clashing cymbals. Let everything that breathes praise the Lord. Praise the Lord. This is the word of God for the people of God.
Thanks be to God. Thank you. My brothers and sisters, I don't know if you remember your first birthday. You don't? Come on, people. Do you don't remember how was it? Do you remember all the people that attended that day? No? Let me ask you a final question. Do you remember, you probably know this one, do you remember what type of cake you had that day?
You
better go to the doctor. You don't remember what happened when you were turning 1 year old? Okay, I know. We probably don't even remember that. We don't remember the first birthday party. Maybe we had a cake. Maybe we're present, some friends. But it's nearly impossible. It's nearly impossible for us to remember that day and or understand everything was about. You probably realized
that what a birthday is around you, probably when you are turning 3 or 4 years old. You start noticing that something special is coming around you. And you discover everyone had gathered just for you in that particular day. Because this is your special day. The presents, the cake are for you. The decoration in the place is for you. Every single detail in that birthday party is for you. Just for you. This is your special day. When we turn 50, that doesn't happen, but that's another story. Parents made these special day and special arrangements in their calendars, writing unique invitation cards for all your small bodies. And who could attend that birthday party? And that was special. Your family also did a special. They save and mark their calendars, so your uncles and aunts and nieces and whoever was there, I mean, no nieces, but cousins were there for you. You undoubtedly got a special present probably from your grandma and your grandpa. And it was just as special for them to see your faces smiling as you were opening your gifts. And probably with good voices, I love very good voices, everybody gather, tune and untune, to sing you. Exactly. Everybody was singing happy birthday for you. As time passes, you realize that everyone who loves you pauses their lives to celebrate your birthday. Very little compared to the joy of seeing a child's face on his or her birthday, full of happiness. You probably remember what I asked you at the beginning of the worship service. Do you remember when I came here and I said, good morning, everyone, and I told you about what it was going to be, the service, and I said we are in the last part of our sermon series, and then what was my question? Are you ready to worship? And you said, yes! And that yes, brothers and sisters, that yes means a lot of things. It's not just three letters. It means a lot of things. It means, yes, we are ready to worship our Lord. This is what you're saying when you say yes. If you didn't know, well, take it in account. This is what you were saying. Yes, we are ready to worship our Lord. When God's people come together just to celebrate who God is, imagine God's delight. This is just for God. How happy it must make our God and our Creator whenever God's people pause their lives, pause their calendars, and they come to worship and have this time of celebration, of praise and songs and music and prayers and listen to a sermon and offering, all this just for God. Just for God. And we offer our talents and we offer everything that we are. God delights in us through our worship actions, and those actions shape us to grow more in Christ. So worship, brothers and sisters, is an act that allows us to share what our faith life means to us.
It allows us to express our love of God and our thankfulness for what God has done for us. Worship is also a way for us to grow in our faith and continue experiencing God. Every time that we gather here as the body of Christ, we grow together. We learn from each other. In worship, you and I have an opportunity to confess our sins, cry out to God, and prayfully ask for the things we need. We can pray for our own needs and put other people's need in God's hands. We turn to God in worship, both in adoration and in request. And it's interesting because John Wesley, he wanted us to have the best in worship. So he wrote the directions for singing. So imagine we come to here and we know some of us have good voices, others don't have good voices, but we still try to do our best, right? If you see your neighbor there like, it means that you are not doing good. But most of us try to do our best, right? Some others think that they sing beautifully, but they don't. But anyway, everybody knows their talents. But John Wesley was so into that. And I'm sure that Charles Wesley was the one who really put this in place. But he, in 1761, they offered a publication, Select Hymns, and in the hymn book, for the early Methodist, he wrote the same. He wrote 7 different rules. And one of the rules that I'm going to read for you is very interesting. This is rule number 4. And I will read it for you, okay? It says, sing lustily. How do you pronounce that?
Lustily.
That word. You know, my Texan accent sometimes is not good. And with good courage. Beware of singing as if you were half dead and half asleep. But lift up your voice with strength. Be no more afraid of your voice now, nor more ashamed of its being heard than when you sang the songs of Satan. Look at that. He wanted us to really concentrate in our singing. There is another version that says something like, this is probably the non-official version, but it says, sing like you were singing in the bars. Very merrily, right? So sing in the church like you were singing in your previous life in the bars. And that's the reason why I was telling the kids that sometimes you say, I'm happy. And I can see your faces, people. And sometimes there is a disconnection between the lyrics and your faces. But it may seem overdue and even silly, but our singing and worship of God often become sometimes mechanical. And meaningless. So how are you doing in your time of worship? How are you doing in your time of worship? So here it comes. So where does faith meet life? Faith meets life when we enter worship not only with thanksgiving, but also with reverence. And Psalm 100, verse 4 says, enter his gates with thanksgiving and his courts with praise. Give thanks to him. Bless his name. This is what this beautiful psalm says. And one of the things I admire and I'm jealous, in the good sense, okay? In the good sense, about our siblings in the Roman Catholic Church,
is that when you enter to their sanctuary, to their holy place, no matter what part of the world you are, because I have been in the 16th Chapel, I have been in St. George and St. Peter's Basilica, and when you enter, what you experience is silence and reverence. More than in a time of conversation. We do not listen to the music, prepare for the prelude. And this is a time for us to prepare our spirits. The prelude is the first act of worship. Look at us. Look at us. Our brother in the organ is playing the music and preparing on our spirits. You know what I did last Sunday? And I... It says... We don't have that time of reverence. We don't have a time to prepare our spirit. So the only way sometimes is when we see the pastor and the liturgist coming here. And sometimes we are quiet, but other times we're not. So when do we have the time to prepare our spirits? When do we prepare our spirits to worship the Lord? We do not enter the moment of worship as if we were in a stadium. So let us enter the sanctuary with thanksgiving, but also with respect for that time dedicated only to God. We have 24 hours a day, and we have 7 days a week, and we devote only 1 hour to gather together, to worship, and have that particular time just for God. And just to concentrate in our minds and our spirits, bringing all who we are, our struggles and joys, bringing it to here, to the Lord. So we need to offer that reverence and holiness. Prepare your spirit. Prepare your mind, prepare your heart. It is 1 hour a week when you turn your surroundings completely toward the Creator of all we are and have, our God. It's a time of intimacy and adoration, a time of worship. Faith meets life when you understand that worship is not to entertain you. Even when the pastor sometimes tell silly jokes, but to worship God. Worship is not a time to entertain members with a beautiful choir performance and feel good sermons according to your standards. We worship God with respect, with humility, and with all our being. And if anything, we all are the actors on a stage offering our worship to God, who is the sole audience to our worship. So no, worship is service to God. And we call this liturgy. A Greek term that means the community work. It means the work of the people. So when we are here, we are offering God our own work as a community. With this in mind, each week you receive a bulletin, right? We were talking about the bulletin. I think I left my bulletin there. By using these de facto guidelines, we affirm the spiritual unity of the church in our time of worship. We are in the same page. We're in the same spirit. We're all praying together. We're all listening to the preacher. We are all offering together. We find that this is a time of awareness that we are worshiping God as a community, as people of God. So prepare your spirit. Prepare your mind. Prepare your heart. It is 1 hour a week when you turn your surroundings completely toward the Creator of all we are and have, our God. It is a time of intimacy and adoration, a time of worship. Faith meets life when the offering, gifts, and tithes become an expression of gratitude to God for His many goodnesses and not a payment for our church membership. And the moment we express gratitude to God, we do it in many ways, including offerings and gifts and tithes. However, for many, this has become payment for services. So when the person has that concept in mind, he has to be recognized for what he or she has given. And he or her heart needs that vainglory and not the silence of the joyful giver. In other cases, if there is someone who disagrees with what the pastor said or the determination made by the leadership in the church, then he or she makes a determination not to give, because what he or she considers should be done is not done. You are offering to God through the church. Don't let your pride overcome the joyful giver in you. Prepare your spirit. Prepare your mind. Prepare your heart. It is 1 hour a week when you turn your surroundings completely toward God of all we are and have. Our God, it is a time of intimacy and adoration, a time of worship. Beloved, as we finish this 11-week sermon series called Back to School, we have been able to refresh our beliefs as United Methodists. We are a community of believers who worship together. Each member of the community is accountable to every other member of the community. Of course, we take delight in many things: friendships, hobbies, sports, and television. We probably have a long list of things that delight us. Unfortunately, we make some of these things so important that we choose to worship them instead of or in addition to God. So they become our idols. And God desires that we first seek to love God and our neighbors. So while we may delight in other things, we do not cling to them as if they give us life. So God is our source. Our worship is reserved to God. And this worship can be done anywhere with all of us gathered here or with our actions of faith. So my brothers, as we are concluding this sermon series, and as we are preparing for this time of Advent and Christmas, may you find to celebrate and delight in God each day and be proud of who you are as United Methodist, as a United Methodist worshiper who loves God and His people. So worship God with all who you are. Amen. I invite you now to stand up as you're able, so we can join our voices. But before to sing, remember John Wesley's rules.
Come to time to work.
God of worship, God of love. We come to you every single Sunday just to worship you and to praise you for who you are. We dedicate an hour of our lives just to come and concentrate our lives and our energy in you, O Lord. We prepare the work of the people, the work as a community, just to come and offer who we are. So we ask you, O Lord, that as we worship you, as we praise you, every time we can do it with all our hearts. Invite us, O Lord, to come to you as we are. Challenge us, O Lord, to come to you with a contrite heart and a humble heart. So we pray at this time that every song, every prayer, every time of offering, every sermon that we listen, every time of gathering will be just for you. You are the reason to worship. So we ask this, O Lord, in the name of Jesus Christ, who is honor of our songs and praises. And as we pray, we remember the prayer that you taught to your disciples. As they said, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen.
As citizens of the kingdom and family of God, we are called to use all that we are and all that we have to make this world we live in a better place. As we give our offerings this day, let us prayerfully consider how we can make a difference in the lives of those around us, whether they be a friend or a stranger. The ushers will now collect our tithes and offerings.
Thank you.
nation. King of heaven, accept
these gifts we offer today. We lay them at your feet and pray that you will use them in our very lives to bring love, compassion, justice, wherever it is needed.
In your holy name we pray. Amen.
Church, as I bless you, you bless me. Now to him who is able to keep you from failing and to make you stand without blemish in the presence of his glory with rejoicing. To the only God, our Savior, through Jesus Christ, our Lord, be glory, majesty, power, and authority before all time and now and forever. Amen. God bless you all.